Yeah, and Cindi and I are both very big proponents of affordable housing. We're going to get a chance to get more into that and kind of explain some differences in affordable housing, what it actually is, what the different breakdowns are inside of that, to kind of help explain to everybody what it is, because I know the announcement he made was not vague to an extent, but there's a lot that goes into those kind of plans. So we want to try and delve deeper. Even as we go on, I'd love to be able to talk to somebody a little bit more in detail about it and get some exact intentions on what the plan is going to look like. Guys, we're going to step away and take a quick break this morning. When we come back, we're going to take a look at your Chattanooga real estate market. This is Real Estate Today with Cindi and Jody and Jack on Talk Radio 102.3, The Talk Monster.
We talk Chattanooga, live, local, and listening to you. 102.3 FM.
The Chattanooga Red Wolves kick off the 2022 campaign against Forward Madison FC this Saturday evening at CHI Memorial Stadium. For tickets, go to ChattanoogaRedWolves-SC.com. Kickoff is Saturday at 7. For tickets, go to ChattanoogaRedWolves-SC.com.
The Medicare store by Affordable Medicare Plans is not affiliated with Medicare or any other government agency.
Helping you locally with your Medicare choices. The Medicare store on Highway 58, offering various plans at no cost assistance with no obligation to enroll. See the difference between advice and good advice.
Hey friends, it's time for Don Ledford's March Mayhem pre-owned sales event. Did you know that Don Ledford has over 190 quality pre-owned vehicles available right now? And over 150 of them are SUVs and trucks. There is something for everyone. All domestic and most import brands are available, no matter what you're looking for. Come to Don Ledford's pre-owned department first. Don Ledford Automotive on North Lee Highway in Cleveland, home of Red Tag Savings, where they say yes to quality pre-owned vehicles.
Talk Radio 102.3.
Welcome back to Real Estate Today with Cindi and Jody on Talk Radio 102.3. Guys, if you have a caller question this morning regarding anything for the Tennessee Valley real estate market, please give us a call, 267-1023. You can reach us at our office during the week, 790-7979, or on the Facebook Live video at the Riches Group Facebook page.
We had a little bit of a late start there on the Facebook Live. We've been struggling the last couple of weeks with that. But if you missed it, we were just talking about the interest rates and what they're doing this week. And this week was a little bit quiet. All of our adjustments happened the week before. So interest rates are still hovering around that 5% rate, which is where we expect them to stay for a little while.
So one of the big things to come out of Chattanooga this week is from the mayor's office. Chattanooga Mayor Tim Kelly announces a $100 million affordable housing initiative with the goal to build more than 5,000 new homes in the Chattanooga area in the next 5 years. According to the mayor, the city is kicking off the initiative with an investment of $33 million with the first projects that will see funding by the end of this calendar year. That's a big change. We actually kind of came across this as this came out, so we decided to run a couple of numbers just to see where we're at and kind of what is affordable housing.
I was glad to hear somebody actually define affordable housing for people. So when they talk about affordable housing, they are talking about spending less than 30% of your income on monthly housing.
Yeah, and that includes utilities when you do that figure. You drop down into a lot of people kind of get another term mixed in with affordable housing, and that's low to moderate income housing. Low to moderate income housing has been a big topic nationwide and locally for the last several years. Low to moderate income, low income means that there is a family income of less than 50% of the area median income. They use medians when they talk figures like this because it's a truer representation of actually what's going on than an average. Typically, the average amount is higher because it factors in everything from the highest to the low. The median is the number that is specifically in the middle of all the incomes. 50% of the income is below that number. 50% of it is higher. Moderate income is going to be when a family income is at least 50%, but less than 80% of the area's median income. That's how they figure out those. And that's a big thing in lending and affordability and pricing, because you have to base your home pricing. And when you look at that for affordable housing, is what is actually the area medium income.
Right. And in Chattanooga, we've got a medium income of about $45,500.
Yeah, and that's a big difference when we talk about median versus average. The average income for Chattanooga is right at $69,192.
Mm-hmm.
So if you math based on the median home sale price in Chattanooga for February, that was $302,000. The average home sale price was just shy of $350,000.
Mm-hmm.
So when you actually do the math on that and kind of look to see what it would cost for a buyer to buy, if you bought a house at the median income at $302,000, Say you did a conventional 5% down loan, and at current rates of what we are right now, your monthly payment
at $2,078 below the 30%, which would be your medium income, that would mean that you'd have to have a household income of $83,000.
Which that even puts your median home price well outside of the range of the average income, and mm-hmm. almost double of what your median yeah. income is.
So all of that points to that, yes, there is a huge shortage of affordable housing in the Chattanooga area.
Yeah, and according to the press release from the mayor, years in the area to an average of $290,000. Then you compare that against the most recent March numbers, that still... If you're going average for average, they still had that almost $60,000 under what the actual average home sale was when they set the numbers up for setting the program in place.
Right, right. But it is nice to hear that they are acknowledging that there is a housing problem, and they are coming up with a plan to try to address it. So that was encouraging, rather than just keep throwing out there about interest rates and bidding wars. But then leading up to how we actually got here, if you do some research on the housing shortage, it's not that we just have this big pool of buyers all of a sudden that are wanting to buy homes. It's that we've been heading in this direction for quite a while now. If you look at new home starts from the 1960s all the way through the year 2000, which was pre the market crash before, the average home starts per decade would run between 9 and 11 million homes per year, or per decade. So roughly, we'll just say a million new starts per year nationwide.
Now we actually haven't had that number since 2000, correct?
Correct. So the market bubble before, before the market crash before, we were about a million new starts per year. From 2010 through 2020, we averaged about 7 million, which is 3 million short over that decade. So we went into 2021 3 million houses short just based on that 1 million new home starts per year. Yeah. So last year, being 2021, was the first time in, you know, over a decade that new home starts actually were over 1 million. Well, they were at 1 million. I won't say over. At 1 million for 2021. So that was the first year we didn't add to the deficit.
Yeah, and I think the important thing to remember on that is that's new home starts. That's not total homes on the market or total home need. Total
Correct.
Home need nationwide estimate is around 5.5 million. If the mayor's coming out and saying in Chattanooga we need 5,000 new homes, that's just to catch up to where we are at this particular point in time. That's not making a jump to prepare us for the next decade as we continue to grow. I know a lot of people are anti-growth. They don't like to see cities get overpopulated. If you live in rural areas, those areas are beginning to become more heavily populated. I'm sorry, but there's just a lot of people, and a lot of people have to go somewhere. So it's an inevitability now. So the more apt you are to be in an area that has a great plan,
plan,
you have to have a plan. You have to be able to grow.
Mm-hmm.
You have to be able to continually upgrade and update your infrastructure to be able to handle population increases. We're starting to see that in some more rural areas that are starting to plan ahead, trying to get utilities ran, things like that, to handle those increases that are coming. It is a question of when. It's not a question of are they going to come. It's going to grow.
Mm-hmm. Especially over the last few years, since there's been such a housing shortage, and with the pandemic, that's led to a whole lot of people pushing outside of the city limits and moving, you know, more out into rural areas. And like you said, that's going to affect your utilities, your school systems, everything. So, yeah.
And I think the important thing to remember on that is it's not this where we are right now. You can blame rising prices, increases, inflation. We've been heading this way for 10 years. We've just seen smaller signs of it. And now we're coming to a head to where now, because of COVID, because of world matters, things like that, you know, you have material sitting on a ship that you can't get unloaded to sell in the country. Your demand, you know, can't get to your supply, and your supply can't get to your demand. We're not going to see any decreases on demand for goods in the next century. As the population continues to increase, they have to eat, they have to live, they got to have somewhere to be.
Right, and we need the housing for that.
Mm-hmm.
So, and as Chattanooga and the surrounding areas push for new industries, we need to have the housing for these people that they plan on bringing into town too. So if we're going to be, you know, attracting new industries, we do have to have the housing too. And as prices increase, and like you said, it's been a struggle for builders because with the cost of labor and lumber and land, I mean, that just adds on to the building prices. So with a lot of the builders, they have increased the price range that they're building in because they can't afford to build in starter homes anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So you're seeing them go more toward luxury building, or, you know, just above the average or medium prices, because that's where they have to be in order to make a profit.
It is. And I think the big thing to remember on that is, yes, it's about a profit, but just material purchasing cost wise, you can't build a home for $150,000 anymore.
No.
Those days have gone past just based on material costs to be able to do that. And then still be able to have labor and to find the labor to build it inside of a time frame that's, you know, acceptable to a lot of people. That's the hard part. You know, we have a material shortage. We also have a labor shortage.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know just on the new constructions that we're dealing with, it seems to be a little bit easier this year on materials. So last year it was really touch and go there for a while. We never had any idea what was going to be available. It was some crazy items. I know on one home we couldn't get doorknobs to finish up a house. So it was just crazy things that we were not able to get our hands on. This year doesn't seem to be as hard. Now, don't get me wrong, there's still delays, but the builders are learning to work with it a little bit more and get a little more prepared for it.
Yeah, I think when you have a builder that does multiple homes a year, their best option is to order in bulk as much as possible to an extent.
We're seeing a whole lot of that, and that's not just the builders. Like when we were talking to the Great Backyard last week, mm-hmm. I mean, even you've got all kinds of industry that are starting to order in bulk so that they are prepared for the demand.
Yeah, and I think that's a big thing to remember. Your selection of custom items are going to be a big deal. I can remember I did one that was a new construction build, and they did a cabinetry upgrade. Just a little bit better quality, better built cabinet. You know, the solid wood dovetail cabinets, you know, super nice. Typically not something out of the ordinary. That caused a six-month delay on the completion of the home.
Wow.
Just because they were pumping out all of their standard stock items to get those done and didn't have time to do a lot of the custom orders that they had coming.
Right. Well, and you don't see a whole lot of customs right now either. A lot of the builders are waiting until the homes are getting, until the cabinets are installed. Then they're actually putting them on the market so that they can keep track of where their costs are on them, because it's mm-hmm. hard for them to predict what, you know, how much they're going to have in a house by the mm-hmm. time they get through all the increases.
Yeah, and that's the thing. And we started seeing it last year. We started seeing the addendums where you're actually adding, you know, a price bump
mm-hmm.
built into the contract. I think now a lot of that has been, you're still seeing the price bump, but they're waiting to put it on
right
much later, so they do have a better idea of where your pricing is going to be.
Right, and I was shocked at how many buyers are willing to sign that open-ended contract with, you know, the material price bump. That kind of blew my mind, so I'm kind of glad that we're not seeing that and they're just holding off and putting it on the market a little bit later.
Yeah, and I think so. And I know we were talking with several agents around the area. You know, last year was the year for land. Everybody wanted to buy land. We're getting out of the city. We're going to build our dream home. And then they buy the land, and then they price the house.
Yeah.
And they haven't started building yet.
Yeah. Well, building doesn't mean you're going to get everything you want. You're going to get a good lesson in budgeting, especially in today's market. You're going to pick and choose where you want to spend your money.
Oh, yeah, Devlin. How what is the thinnest sheet of board that I can put down for a floor and a roof and not fall through? We're going to have to say some
that's not somewhere. Quite where I would skip. But, but and it's easy to get carried away. You know, you're looking at granite. All of a sudden, they start talking quartz with you, and it sounds good. I mean, I'll give them that. The salespeople are good. And then you just look at it a couple of thousand here, a couple of thousand there. And it's
2.3.
What in the world?
When we give the hourly keyword, you text IT to 95819. Starting at 8 weekday mornings, you have 10 chances to win $100. Grand prize, $25K. The $25K payday on 102.3 FM, The Talk Monster.
I'm sorry I'm late. Traffic is terrible.
It sure is. But on top of that, gas prices have been skyrocketing. I can't believe how expensive gas has gotten recently.
Prices at the pump are up, but I never pay full price for gas. I just use the free Get Upside Gas app that pays you cash back for every gallon of gas you buy.
Wait a minute. Are you saying you actually get paid cash when you buy gas with the Get Upside app?
Yes, up to 25 cents a gallon cash back every time I buy gas.
And does that actually add up to anything?
I'll make $200 to $300 this year.
Wow, that's serious extra cash. I'm downloading the free Get Upside app now.
Download the free Get Upside app now in the App Store or Google Play to save up to 25 cents a gallon when you buy gas.
Use improvement needs. Lee Company. We are A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau and trusted by thousands of homeowners in the communities we serve. Our team is ready to assist with all your home maintenance needs, heating and air conditioning, plumbing, and electrical. Experience the convenience of calling one phone number for all your home maintenance needs. Call Lee Company today at 423-567-8877 or visit leecompany.com.
You've probably heard about dental implants, but do you know what they are? An implant is a titanium screw that permanently attaches a replacement tooth. At Chattanooga Dental, we can use implants to replace teeth one at a time.
For the love of the climb. For the love of the fall. For the love of knowing your kid's laughter is the sweetest music there is. For the love of Tennessee, travel safe. Brought to you by the Tennessee Department of Tourist Development, the Tennessee Association of Broadcasters, and this station.
Talk Radio 102.3.
Welcome back to Real Estate Today with Cindy and Jody. Get your real estate questions answered on the air. Call or text 267-1023. We're also answering questions through the live video on the Richardson Group Facebook page. Guys, I know we've thrown a lot of numbers to you guys, and sometimes numbers are boring, but I don't enjoy them, but I like to see what the trends look like, because you can see if you know how to read a set of numbers and you can understand how a trend works, you can see a lot of things coming well before they get here. I know we talked a lot about purchasing, building homes in the Chattanooga area, a lot of great things that are coming up. But I came across an interesting number the other day while I was doing a lot of the research for this stuff, and it involved renting versus buying in Chattanooga. And there right now, the household that rent and the households that actually own are actually pretty much split dead even. 48% of the households in Chattanooga actually rent, 52% own.
That's surprising to me.
That is to me, too. I know Chattanooga has become a big – there are a lot of rental opportunities in Chattanooga.
Mm-hmm.
But surprisingly, the median income – or excuse me, the average rental rate is around $1,200 a month, which is still, based on median income, that's still a pretty good chunk of what you have going out every month going towards your household living, not including food, fuel to get to work, things like that, and all those other – you're kind of in that area of what we consider house poor. to an extent.
Yeah, nobody wants to be house poor. You want to be able to go on vacation when you want to go on vacation.
Yeah, so one of the other things that we kind of came across, we came across an article that was kind of interesting to an extent. It was actually from Realtor.com. There are a couple other places that have actually carried this article over, not with as much detail. And it was rent versus buying. Buying a home is more affordable in a growing number of cities. So actually areas where it is cheaper to buy than it is to rent. Chattanooga was not on that list.
No,
unfortunately.
No.
We're trying to get it there. But with a median home price of $302,000, it's kind of hard to catch something in there. We did have a couple of Tennessee cities that were on it. Memphis was actually on the list.
No, because if you look at $302,000, putting 5% down, that puts your payment at about $2,078. And you said the average rental was how much?
$1,200,
right. Now, if you don't include tax and insurance in that mortgage payment, that would put your payment closer to $1,522. So you're much closer, not if you're not considering your taxes and escrow. So just make sure when you're reading some of these articles that it's your whole payment. It's not just your principal and interest.
Yeah, and they've actually come back and updated this article since the first time I saw it. The first time I saw it, they actually did not include escrow and PMI into it. Well, and actually they were figuring on it. Actually, they were figuring on a 20% down payment, which for most homeowners, they're doing that 3%, 5%.
Right, right.
Or a zero down FVA, USDA, something like that. What shocked me, though, was Memphis. Memphis is a big area. Their average home price or median was $244,000.
Yeah, that doesn't shock me. My son went to college in Memphis, and definitely their average home price there is less than in this area.
Yeah, I lived in Memphis for several years, many years ago. And I think the thing is Memphis has kind of seen what Chattanooga has with, they've had the expansion outward from Memphis, but they've not had that recent influx back into Memphis that Chattanooga has seen.
Right. It's not cool to live downtown Memphis.
Yeah. Who else? See, Birmingham was on there too.
Really?
Yeah, Birmingham was a median listing price, $264,000. With a monthly payment at $1,105, monthly average rent
$1,081.
So pretty close.
Yeah.
They won, because the original one, I looked at this one, they had a house in Birmingham was around $800.
Yeah. Well, I think in this area, if you're looking at rent for $1,200 or purchase for $2,000, you're looking at $800 a month difference between the two. And there are some advantages to both, just depending on your your circumstances. One, if the $800 a month is not going to make you house poor, then you might want to consider buying. It gives you, your interest is tax deductible. So even though you're paying out a little bit more, your income tax return is going to be a little bit more too. So that does help offset some of that.
Yeah, that's the big thing that a lot of people don't really think about when you look at what your costs are going to be, because you're going to have costs that continue to go on. And we were talking to some people today, they just replaced a water heater yesterday. And it shocked me at just the cost of the water heater.
Now, granted, he did an upgraded water heater and an upgrade size and stuff, but I'm with you. It was about twice as much as what I expected to hear.
Yeah, and I think one thing about the size that he got is kind of a standard size.
Oh, it's a little bigger. I think, yeah, it's a little bigger.
Yeah,
but
40 to 50 is kind of a standard size.
Yeah, yeah. It was still shocking.
Mm-hmm. It was, and I mean, the thing is, I always love, when I rent, is I can always go, hey, come fix my AC, it's not working, come fix my dishwasher or whatever. Mm-hmm. Now it's my wife says, hey, the dishwasher's not working, and then it takes a trip to Home Depot.
Well, and as a homeowner, I think you also have to keep an eye on things and kind of forecast. Appliances only have a life expectancy of so long. So if you know that all of your appliances are going to hit that expectancy at the same time, you might want to upgrade, ahead of time. One at a time, so that you're not hit with that big expense all at once.
Yeah, especially now. It seems like we're seeing more to where a lot of the newer appliances aren't having that long-term work life that a lot of the older appliances do.
Oh, I completely agree with that. I've got a refrigerator. It's the same age as my son, 23 years old, and that thing is still going.
So if you buy an older home, think twice before you decide to rip out all the appliances.
You might want to keep that yellow or gold harvest refrigerator and appliances.
Look, banana yellow, avocado green, flamingo pink. You know, they may be ugly colors, but those things work like a charm.
Well, anybody that knew my stepdad, he was very, I won't say cheap, we'll say frugal, but he took his Harvest Gold appliances and sent them to an auto shop and had them painted. Yeah,
I can see that.
They looked awesome. I mean, they look great. So, I mean, it's completely doable. And at that point, it's just kind of retro and cool.
Yeah. Well, and very son, I know the house that I grew up in, it had a refrigerator from the 1960s in it. And this was in the 90s. So the thing worked for 30 years and worked great. We kept it in there through the two renters after we moved out of it. So, yeah, the thing lasted forever. Mm-hmm. The thing, it lasted as long as the house did before we had to tear the house down.
Wow.
So, yeah, so we had caught a break on some of those older things. A lot of the newer ones just don't.
So, back to what we were talking about, though. So, you've got to weigh that out when you're thinking about buying versus renting. It's not just the monthly payment. It is also the maintenance and just upkeep of owning a home. Now, you do also get the appreciation. So, and like we were talking about earlier, just over the last couple of years, home prices have gone up double digits. So you do get the yearly appreciation that you're not going to get as a renter. And then, Jack, I think we were also talking about, and as far as renting, too, a whole lot of people are going to get notices as their leases come due this year, because with what the market's doing, rental prices are also going up.
You know, they are, and that's kind of the thing. I've already had a couple of friends call me about that. This year they got leases coming up in the next month or so, and they've gotten their new lease notices and everything like that. So if you have a lease coming up this year, chances are, if you haven't already gotten it, you're probably going to. Actually, after I talked to them, I pulled some numbers just for them to see where we were at. And for Chattanooga, you know, we kind of said the average apartment rate on that's $1,238. And that was the February number. That's actually a 15% increase from February of last year.
Really?
So they have actually kind of stayed, rent costs have kind of stayed where we have seen an increase on home sale costs.
So if the predictions are true, then you'll see a 5% increase in 2022. Yeah,
and 5% for 2022 sale prices. So I think they're expecting the same. And I would probably say that rent is probably a little behind on that. Mm-hmm. So it may be a little bit higher rate as you're trying to catch itself back up with the current rental market.
Mm-hmm.
So that may be something to look at, too. On that side, is your rent increase going to push you into a point where it's more economical to buy than continue to rent? Now, granted, I mean, there are a lot of people that love to rent, and they'll pay whatever their rental cost is. But for a lot of people, that may be the better option to go ahead and get into a home, something that you actually own instead of, you know, you're paying yourself for instead of someone else.
Yeah. And if you're thinking about...